music industry was like in a lull. There wasn't anything great happening for reggae. Radio was playing like Lala Calypso, Byron Lee, most of the announcers. They really didn't align themselves with the poorer classes.
We couldn't afford to buy records, so we listened to the radio. And anything the radio play is that year. So I wasn't really into them things. I was really into, like, you call it spiritual music, you know, to it get more revolutionized.
Message to be delivered, to be heard, and that was one of his main things, to be heard. You know, when am I going to be heard? When the radio station is going to play my music?
Singers like Bob Marley had to wait a little longer for their moment because downtown a different musical revolution was taking place. It started when a new generation of producers had a simple idea to put the instrumental backing track of the hit on the B-side. They called it Version.
Version basically is a great idea. Version was just putting a track of the song on the other side of the record. If you like a song and you buy it, it's great really just to hear the track. I mean, you know, in a way it's almost like the first karaoke opportunities. And then after that, then people would start to talk over the tracks.
Wait in town and tell the people about the musical disc coming your way.
The first stars of this new music were the DJs, the flamboyant frontmen of the sound systems who started to rap over the versions. The emerging new producers like King Tubby and Lee Perry started to record them. Success was instant.
The first two songs which we were telling the people on the station, Rule the Nation with Version, the two songs was playing on the radio. But believe me, I never even believed them weren't going away at all, because to me, it's just too much tune this we're going to just play and after a while, dump, you know? But then the two tune become number one and number two.
God let the world know how much I need you so. Still I want the world to know. Gee, we are never let you go, you know. Oh, to be good, be good.
Believe me, it's like, it was such a big surprise for me, because I used to have this little bike that I've been riding down the street and you would start block the road now and check me out and tell me how great I am and how much they love what I'm doing, you know what I mean? So it's like, that was really something exciting for me.
DJs talked about everyday experience and turned it into a kind of poetry, and they spoke in patois. The music was at one with its audience again.
The principles that are used in hip-hop and rap today are the same principles that were used in the originals in the 60s when the likes of a Count Machuki and a Daddy Roy talked over the dub. They'd say simple stuff started
great, greater, this station, you know?
And that principle was passed down to the child. The mother reggae passed it on to the child called hip-hop, bottom line.
It wasn't just the DJs who were having fun with versions. Soon the producers got in on the act. Versions had become dub.
People would mess around with the tracks and dub the tracks and have the repeat echoes and all these different sounds and pull things in and drop things out. All that started in Jamaica. And all that is what is, you know, kind of a basis for pretty much most of the dance records that exist today.
Watch with the bass. Give me some piano. Drum and bass rolling, drum and bass. Strictly drum and bass. Piano with some echo.
Dub to me is an artistic expression of internal molecular energy.
Out of the bass. Along with some echo, then we give you bass alone, rolling bass, come in drums.
I mean, you play the right dub and people have to take their clothes off and go on crazy and they don't drink a glass of wine yet.
Singers like Bob Marley had yet to see any benefit from the changes afoot in Jamaica, But that new wind would soon blow in his direction. The key to unlocking the door was an old friend of Marley's who'd built a reputation through dub and was now in a position to help him, Lee Scratch Perry. Perry had some success in Britain with his band The Upsetters and teamed up with Marley in 1969.
We'd really started our independent career and left Coxon because Jamaica knew about the Wailers. But the world didn't. And we decided to venture with Lee Perry, who had an acquaintance also with the UK through the Upsetters band. And we did that experiment also with him, which also turned out to be pirate and bootleg and unfair situation where we didn't get none out of that.
By ganja and music reggae from Jamaica. That's what Jamaica have to give. Jamaica means Jesus Christ. He give you the drum. He helps his Marcus Garvey. Yes, he did not die in Egypt. He's on my head.
Salvador Dali says, no one has to understand whether I am serious or joking. Not even me. And I think that is the ultimate in artistic freedom. Well, Lee Perry is another one. Lee Perry says, must remember, everything starts from scratch.
The original rock from Egypt, and I was there from the time when God did wonderful, beautiful Egypt for his people.
He's a professor at work in his lab, and he makes music out of anything. He takes a quart bottle, and he throws water in, and he knocks, bip, bip, bip. You get one note, dubs that on.
Then I am Moses.
Then he puts some more water in.
Where is my rod?
He gets a different sound. Bit, bit, bit. Then he puts that on. And by the time he fills that bottle, you have about five tracks of five different sounds. Then he mixes those into one. The guy's a genius.
If you want a big tree, let me tell you that we are a small island.